Maybe we can just present the consortium with a picture. And what was important is that to tackle the problem of smart grid. Smart grid is just only grid or ICT community. It's we need people, experts from the ICT world, communication, information technology, and from the grid world. It's exactly what we try to set up in this consortium, having experts on both sides. But, you know, those experts are talking different languages. That was one of the challenge of DREAM, to make sure that those two communities will discuss together and will tackle challenges. Second thing was about the not only having academics or researcher, but having manufacturer and DSOs, because the aim of the project was to create tools and methodology for DSOs, making sure that we'll increase this amount of renewable and best use the asset, the grid, the existing grid. And the objective of the project can be summarized in this sentence, that is how to create the common infrastructure for every player of the grid, from the end user to the producer to the DSO, the system operator, making sure that we have the best use of the assets.
So you have all the key players on board. So this is a, we can say, the consortium, the best consortium for realizing this dream. So the second thing is, what is this common infrastructure dream and what is the vision behind it? This is, I think, we have to explain them once forever.
Yeah. The key issue is related to the fact that for years, and it's still nowadays valid, it's very difficult for the end user to participate to the energy market. So the first thing we wanted to bring was the ability for every end user, you in your home, for instance, acting on the market, making sure you can participate to the grid, to the effort to embedded to increase the amount of renewable we can connect. And for that, you need to be able to access to the energy market. So our first goal was to make sure that every end user was able to access to the energy and balancing market. What we created in addition was some mechanism to make sure that the DSO, system operator, can use the flexibility, for instance, in your place, the your hot water tank or some other appliance that can modulate their power. You can shift in the time. You can sometimes modulate the power of some appliance. And the idea is to offer this flexibility to the grid. But you need some mechanism to exchange information and to know when the grid really need them, need the use of this flexibility. And this was thought with the idea of having the information system distributed, making sure that we can validate close to the end user, avoiding large system to handle at the scale of France, for instance, millions of flexibility devices. Very novelty was about this heterarchic approach.
Yes.
We can discuss a little bit later, but to summarize, it's really about allowing larger amount of DR without investing large amount of money and still keeping the quality of service of the grid.
Yes. I think there's one very important thing you have already explained. The key issue that we used, and I think we did a very good work, the whole notion of flexibility that we brought in. So I think maybe you can explain this, what is flexibility, how we are defining it from customer flexibility. So I think we should spend some time and clarify it. I think it's a very good outcome of the dream.
I fully agree, and there is not a single definition either for the smart grid nor for the flexibility. But we tried with white paper to initiate the definition, or at least our definition. Maybe before starting with flexibility, I need to focus on the key component of the project. So the typical grid is from centralized generation to the end user, from the transmission system operator, very high voltage, to distribution network, medium and low voltage. And if we talk about interconnection of renewables, for instance, wind or PV, what we had in mind at the beginning of the project was we will have some devices, intelligent devices, that will anyway control them, either at medium voltage with advanced RTU, or at your place, at your home, with energy boxes or smart meter. And our idea was to make the bridge, the link between aggregator who will advise you how to consume, how to make the production plan or the flexibility offers for the next day. And the idea is to have this intelligence either in your energy box or at the end for the vision in your smart meter. And from the end user, from the low voltage network toward the transmission system, transferring the information between end user and other type of, let's call that agent, intelligent application that will be in the network as aggregator first, but while aggregating information on the market, they can validate the ability of the grid to sustain such an offer. And from medium voltage to the primary substation, that is the barrier, the frontier between distribution network and transmission network, giving the information to that point so that the transmission system operator can know the information, what will be consumed at that very specific point, and what will be the offer activated in case of market action on the balancing part. So information, of course, is given back to the DSO. The DSO is still handling the system. We need to control the system for security issues and safety issues, but you need, of course, to give back the information to the market, because the idea is not creating a market or local market, but a portal, distributed portal, to bring the offers toward the real market.
So,
to answer to your second question about flexibility, what is flexibility? It's the ability to control a load or production, and either decrease the load or consume a little bit more at a given time. And for renewables, how to dispatch down or to reduce the power coming from the PV panels whenever it's needed. And let's keep in mind that today it's done in some energy market. We were discussing about markets. The markets are happening, in fact, a day ahead, one day before. There are some offers coming. I'm talking about physical markets. And you can even give offers during the day. Yeah. So we integrated this process in Dream framework, but we integrated as well the ability to control closer to real time the remaining flexibilities that Emmanuel and the other colleagues will present later. So this was the Dream vision about the markets and how to build distributed portal for and distributed mechanism for the DSO.
So the flexibility and bidding and marketing is feasible thanks to Dream.
Yes.
Can we conclude like that on this?
Yes. It's the idea.
Everybody think, believe us, so. I can see some faces, but we can trust, yes. Now, very big issue. Yes. We started with this distributed renewable resources management using heterarchical approach. So we really introduced some disruptive way of managing grid. So is it still a dream? this is a dream when we started 4 years ago. It's still a dream, or it is now reality? Can you tell us what is this heterarchy and why we needed it?
Yeah, it's a very good question, and it is related to the fact that when you are distributing the intelligence, you can either reach a local optimum, so you can reach a commitment that is local, but it's not optimal for the whole society. And what we had in mind was to create a structure that will make sure that we'll reach the optimum, to reduce the cost and to have the best use of the flexibility. So let me just give an example, relying on what I was explaining before. You are at the low voltage site in this area. And we are aggregating step by step from low voltage to high voltage the offers on the energy market. If the network is changing the topology,
I was always eating it.
It can happen because of the of some requests for maintenance or for optimization, as we'll see later. For instance, point that is normally open, it's the way we are designing the grid now, between two substations. There is always some kind of links between them, but we open the grid at one point. If the grid point, the normally open point, is switched from one place to another, all the aggregation you did for the market must be done again, because the user that are belonging in this area are not anymore in the left primary substation, but in the right primary substation. Second example, that's great that Mark is telling me that I'm late, but only two slides remaining. Second example is how to manage a congestion, a technical constraint in your electrical network, because electrical network is not a copper plate. It's not because you have an existing network, electrical network, that you can inject large amount, huge amount of energy. It's not that easy. And what can happen, depending on the sizing of the grid, is that in some area you can have, for instance, an overload, too much current running in a line. And the idea was for DREAM, this heterarchic approach, how to automatically group together, aggregate together actors so that we can reach a global optimum. In this case, it's obvious that all the players after the line are participating to the congestion. So what we are creating is automatically this area where the communication is embedded between all the actors. And if this is not working, this is not enough, the heterarchy is pushing even more and saying, okay, let's move to a larger area where we can add more flexibilities. Before, we're talking about flexibility of the end user. Now, while considering this large area, we are considering as well the flexibility of the grid. So reconfiguration and how to shift the normally open point from one point to another. So that was my explanation about heterarchic approach.
I am looking at the faces, so I think something they have got it. So it's more a reality than a dream. But let me say, because we are talking of this distributed architecture, there are some weaknesses, or we have these weaknesses in terms of interaction between the agents, or we don't have anything.
Yes, and we will discuss a little bit later about the methodology we created. But if you distribute intelligence, it can happen that one decision you take in one area will impact one other area.
Yes.
And the grid can start oscillating.
Yes.
And that was one of the big issues we will present in the second section about the framework.
Yeah, this is, I think, some criticalities we know, and we will discover it. So it's a very good way to introduce this issue to discuss in the second session. So I thank you, Rafael. I think your interrogation is all right. So.